the remarkable team that we have working with us that helped Texas respond to aid their fellow Texans in harm's way during a time such as a hurricane. Let me give you a timeline of what we're dealing with and then make some very important update points. Our best assessments as we stand right now is that the hurricane is going to be quite severe, very powerful winds with a strong impact that I'll tell you more about shortly. The key, however, that I want to make right now is that for the areas in southeast Texas that will be closest to the point where the hurricane will come across the shoreline, those people still have only about 5 hours to evacuate. There have been reports from local county judges as well as other local officials raising concern about the people in these regions where the hurricane may be coming across the shore, about the number of people who have not yet evacuated. And the concern is that maybe the people in those areas are not fully aware about the severe danger that people are facing where the hurricane will come across the shoreline. We anticipate the onset of the tropical storm force winds to hit Texas around 7 p.m. tonight, and then landfall of Laura should occur around 1 a.m. tonight, and people in that area will be dealing with the ravages of that storm for about a few more hours, but we do anticipate the storm being out of Texas by tomorrow night. Beginning about 9 a.m. tomorrow morning, we will begin the process of going in and going through rescues. But it's important for people to know that from about 7 p.m. tonight until about 9 a.m. in the morning, it will be a little bit of a lockdown time period for the ability of rescuers and aiders to get in and to provide support for anybody in the local regions. And so we urge everybody who may be in harm's way to take these few last hours to get out of harm's way. And it may only be a day or two that you are required to be out of harm's way. But because of the power of this storm, if you are unable or do not get out of harm's way, the reality is for almost a 24-hour time period, there will be no ability for rescuers or aiders to get in and assist you in any way. So as I said, we do expect landfall around midnight tonight. This has been categorized repeatedly as an unsurvivable storm surge where it will be hitting. And that storm surge could continue inland for about 30 miles. We do expect tropical storm winds to begin around 7 or 8 p.m. tonight. And gathering as it continues through Texas, the winds will begin in Jefferson and Orange County areas. And then, as I said before, we anticipate the hurricane coming across shore around midnight and expect Category 4 storm moving swiftly through Texas. Understand this, and that is that people will see a cone area of where the hurricane cone is expected to move through Texas and Louisiana. Importantly, winds are going to be heavy winds will be occurring outside of the cone, and those high winds will continue as the storm moves up through Texas into northeast Texas. Wind in this storm, wind is going to be the biggest threat. Tropical storm winds are likely to occur as far north as Longview. Storm surge is also a big problem with 10 to 15 feet storm surge around the Jefferson County area. We should expect some flash floods in various regions where the storm will be going through, and those flash floods could spill into rivers, and the rivers could overflow. The storm should exit the state by midnight tomorrow. Going back to the rivers, the one river that we do anticipate having the greatest challenges is the Sabine River. The Sabine River in the past, and we expect this time also, could spill over into areas around Orange as well as Deweyville. And people in those areas need to be aware of the high probability of facing high water. We do expect power outages in the areas hardest hit. I want to make a very important point about something that we have experienced in the past that's caused the loss of life that people may be unaware of. If you lose power, it's very important that you do not bring your generators inside a home. That can lead to carbon monoxide poisoning. You need to leave those generators outside of your home. A couple of updates. First, a recap that I'm going to add to this recap. On Sunday, I declared a disaster in 23 counties. On Monday, the president granted an emergency declaration for these counties. Yesterday, I added three counties to the declaration. And yesterday, I also asked the president to grant Texas's request for Category B assistance, and he granted that request yesterday. Today, I added three more counties to the disaster declaration: Camp, Ellis, and Tarrant counties. The reason why Ellis and Tarrant are added is because they are serving as sheltering locations. For the counties that may be concerned about the impact this storm could have on them, obviously we remain flexible with regard to expanding the counties that could be added to the disaster declaration. That will be dependent upon whether or not those counties are going to be impacted by the storm. For these new counties that I'm adding to the disaster declaration today, I'm asking the president to add these counties to our federal declaration. Some updates with regard to the assets that we have already deployed. We've already deployed 400 buses, 38 aircraft, 82 boats, 202 high-profile vehicles, and 60 ambulances, with an additional 75-plus paratransit vehicles that have been ordered that will be available to be provided to assist in the movement of people. We have more than 5,000 people that are already sheltered, and we are prepared to take in many more as we continue to encourage everybody to evacuate from regions that could be the greatest impacted by the hurricane. We're already preparing for the recovery. So the update on the Disaster Recovery Task Force is this. The Texas Division of Emergency Management Recovery Personnel are in place for deployment post-landfall. Damage assessment teams for local jurisdictions have been developed, and they are being distributed for timely reporting on local damages after the landfall. Volunteer organizations active in disaster are currently staging resources, and personnel are ready to deploy as the affected areas are cleared for reentry. And we have developed and distributed an online platform for disaster survivors to request assistance and provide their damage information. And that is all for my report right now. Chief Kidd, would you like to add?
Mr. Governor, so thank you. And I need to reemphasize the danger factor of this storm. It's been a while since we've seen Cat 3, Cat 4 winds in Texas. We know the damage that that does. Power restoration, Governor, will be longer than what we'd normally expect because of the high winds. You said yesterday that this is not a Harvey storm. We completely agree with that. The rainfall will be different, but the winds will be very important for us to watch. Even though more people lose their lives during surge or flood events, in this event, I'm really worried about the wind just as you are. Our rescue personnel are available. They will be hunkered down through the hours of the storm. I know that they will risk their lives to get out there. My urge and plea with Texans is, if you have the chance to evacuate now, please do so.
Very good. We'll take some questions.
Governor, here in Austin, shortly after we announced that the code would be used as a transitional site,
Sure. Let us give you an update on it. Chief Demkid has that information for you.
So, Rudy, thank you. And let's get the story straight on this, and I appreciate the question. I did talk to the city of Austin this morning. Here's their explanation of what happened. They had booked hotel rooms and reserved them through the process. But because we had been asking people to evacuate, some people went straight to hotel rooms. So while we had believed we had rooms reserved, those rooms were being filled up by other people that were evacuating. At 5 o'clock this morning, City of Austin shut down COTA. They reopened at 10 a.m. this morning. And if we have to open up the convention center here, we've already talked to them about having a place to temporarily put people until we stabilize out the local hotel rooms. Now, we're also using hotels in Hays County and in Williamson County, and we'll probably be pushing some up into Bell County as well. So there are still plenty of hotel rooms available. This is trying to balance out the load right now of regular people driving their own cars and reserving hotels, as well as those that we are trying to work on people coming to us for locations. So we'll get this balanced out. We will have plenty of places. For instance, in Dallas, they're only at 39% occupancy right now. There are plenty of hotel rooms across the state of Texas, and we're just going to keep load balancing this out as we get people out of harm's way. And Rudy, and we'll keep talking to them for the decisions that they made, and they've been great partners to us. We're not going to bash the partners right now. The cities that are helping us with evacuees are doing great work, and we're going to continue to support them as much as we can. Thank you.
This actually, I consider to be a good sign in this regard, and that is what this means, is there has been a large number of people who decided on their own the need to evacuate, and they did get out of harm's way. The math behind this is it means there are more people out of harm's way. Go ahead.
Are we going to see Contraflow traffic? If so, when?
Sure. Chief?
So Contraflow takes about 42 hours to set up. Whenever we think about the logistics that go into shutting down lanes, getting people off of roads, reversing traffic, setting up law enforcement and TxDOT at every location. So the window for Contraflow has closed. We're too close to the storm for that. Now, we may use additional service roads. We've got DPS aircraft that are flying, checking for checkpoints right now to put additional folks in to move people through intersections. But at this point, the window for Contraflow has closed.
Governor, do you plan to be anywhere near Dent tomorrow, or is your schedule kind of in flux on that?
Could I get you to repeat? I missed the first part of the question.
Do you plan to be surveying the damage tomorrow, or are your plans in flux?
We will be surveying the damage as quickly as possible. And we do not want to get in the way of those who are either in danger or those who are providing immediate rescue. And so the timing of my visiting the areas that were hardest hit will depend upon facts on the ground. TxDOT's been doing a fabulous job, both with regard to deploying those vehicles as well as, you know, making strategies such as waiving tolls on the people who are trying to evacuate, as well as assisting with making sure that the roadways will be as cleared as possible. So TxDOT has been very aggressive in responding to this hurricane.
Yeah, Rudy. So again, thanks for the clarifying question. I want to be clear about this. If it's a family that stayed together and they've traveled in their car together and they're going to a hotel together, unless they have signs or symptoms, there's no need for them to be tested. Once we open, if we get to the point of open in congregate settings, maybe like the Austin Convention Center, if they go into that convention center, we'll offer testing for people coming into that facility. Yeah, so again, there's about 1,700 testing locations across the state of Texas right now, so we have plenty of capacity to do testing. But let's play this out a little bit. If the city of Austin opens a convention center because of a need, we will check in the people that go there. We will offer them testing at that location.
How's the supply chain holding up as far as groceries, gasoline, for people outside for the rest of the state? Should they be charging into their ATVs, or
My observation is looking pretty good. This is the type of event where most Texans have taken it very seriously, and they're realizing the necessity to respond as well as to obtain the supplies they need. But our local providers have done a great job of making sure their supply chain is open. Those involved in providing fuel have done a good job of maintaining supply chains. And so right now, the supply chains are looking pretty good. Listen, we're always engaged. For example, you mentioned the next few years. We're always involved every session in addressing health insurance. Sure. Yeah, so when the session arrives, I have no doubt that one of the issues we will be taking up is making sure that we're doing all we can to make sure Texans have access to health care.
Any more questions on
Sure. All right. Thanks, guys. Thank you.